Price check!
Hello and welcome to the first episode of Price Check. In these videos, I'm going to take a look at pick ban and try to figure out win conditions for each team based on items and the items decisions that were had and the item decisions that would have to be made because of the pick ban phase. I know this is only one way to look at the game, but it's one of my favorite ways to look at the game because I think it helps players understand what part of the game they're going to be stronger than the enemy in, which is a great piece of information to consider, especially in a competitive environment. Second, we're going to analyze the key moment in the game, and we're going to try to figure out if items helped us get to that point in the game or if they played a pivotal role in that fight. Lastly, we're going to try to figure out any alternative champions or build paths that could have salvaged the game. Now, this is completely theoretical. I'm not saying, oh, if they only did this, they would have won the game. But it's a fun thought process to go through, and it's a good way to analyze games once they're finished, just so that you know going into the next game that you could make a better decision if it's available to you. And in the pick ban phase, the first champion that was locked in was Aphelios. And Aphelios is obviously one of the best champions in the game. He still is one of the best champions in the game, even after the latest patch. He goes Essence Reaver and Infinity Edge in almost all of his games because they help him spike really hard, and they're just two very good items from a stats perspective and a gold efficiency perspective. They're an expensive build. It requires 6,700 gold, but once you get to that 6,700 gold mark, you are extremely powerful and can solo carry some team fights, depending on how long the team fight lasts. Team Liquid decided to pick Senna and Jarvan. And looking back at this period in time, I think a lot of people are going to wonder, was trading Senna for Aphelios a good decision? Because a lot of teams made that decision during this patch in pro play. Senna usually goes Mirror Mana into a lethality item. In this game, she went Mirror Mana into Edge of Night. Personally, I think Edge of Night is a horrible item. It does pass the test for gold efficiency. It's about 97% efficient. About 800 gold that you're spending on Edge of Night is coming from health, which isn't really going to help against the enemy team because Vhagar is going to one-shot you. Aphelios isn't going to care if you have an extra couple hundred health. He's just going to blow you up. It's most likely not going to be the difference in an extended team fight. And I understand the decision that they made was, I'm afraid of Vhagar, I would like a spell shield. But as we'll see in the game, Doublelift doesn't even use a spell shield when he needed to. Shurnfire picked Jarvan, which I think is a comfort pick for him, and he was filling in a tough situation for Team Liquid. Obviously, Broxah had his visa issues, so I think it's probably a pick that they made because of comfort, and they wanted him to have a champion he was used to. I don't think that he has a limited champion pool. I don't know much about Shurnfire, but the fact that they went out of their way to pick Jarvan makes me think that he's one of his best champions. The way that Cloud9 responded in the next phase of the draft was with their jungler, Lee Sin, and Tahm Kench. One thing you'll notice is that the supports and the junglers all have the same items. This happens a lot because there are like efficient ways to get attack damage, cooldown reduction. They're not very expensive, and that's a good basis for junglers, including like a stopwatch, because stopwatches can be very impactful during the first 20 minutes or so in the game when you're really trying to build up a lead and make big plays. And then on the supports, we have Gargoyle Stoneplate, which is not, in my opinion, a very good item from an efficiency perspective, but the build path helps you do some interesting things. So you can justify building a stopwatch on a support, which can help you during an engage. It can help you during a gank or defending against a gank. It's a very good item. And then you get the defensive stats, magic resistance and armor, which is good. And then the active, I think, is a little underwhelming a lot of the time, because even if Thresh is in your face, he's really not the priority champion. So if you're spending time killing Thresh, it's good for the enemy team already. So I don't really love Gargoyle Stoneplate. Like if I was building a team comp purely through items, but I think because of the game states that a lot of professional supports get into, it's something that a lot of them are comfortable on and their teams are telling them to build. So I'm not going to blame anyone for that. Like if the team wants you to do it, you're going to have to probably do it. The next part of the draft is where I thought it got pretty interesting from an items perspective, because Azir is one of the best stat checkers in the game. Stat checker is a word that's been, or a phrase that's been used more recently by people like LS to describe champions who, just by building certain items and scaling in the game, they're going to have a lot of stats on them. And if you can't beat them before they get to that point, they're going to overwhelm you because of how strong they are with stats, with the raw stats. And in the mid lane, we have Azir versus Veigar, and they're both building very different items for very different reasons. Morellonomicon and Gnasher's Tooth is, let's see, how expensive is that? Gnasher's Tooth is 3,000 gold, and Morellonomicon is also 3,000 gold, so we have 6,000 gold for those two items. And then Hextech GLP is 2,800, and Twin Shadows is 2,400. So Veigar is going to spike earlier in the game, which is helpful for two reasons. If Veigar is ahead, these items play really well with his Keystone Glacial Augment, which is going to freeze enemy champions, which is going to help them get picks, and can help them snowball a lead. And Cloud9 has been a team that has used Veigar specifically because of the way that he plays on the map and can use his baby cage to just force the enemy team into a bad situation. So Hextech GLP and Twin Shadows are also good because it's cheaper to get to that point. So if Cloud9 was in a situation where they were losing the game by a couple thousand gold, he could use these items to create a game state where they recoup a lot of that disadvantage that they have, meaning they can set up around an objective a little better. They can go for a pick, which is something that Lee Sin also likes doing. So it's an interesting thing to think about, because somebody like Azir is saying, okay, we're going to get to the 20-minute mark, the 25-minute mark. I'm going to have my two items completed, and we're just going to 5v5 team fight you. Cloud9 instantly said, no, we're not, because I don't want to fight you in a fair fight. I want to make sure that I have a one-man advantage by blowing up one of the people on the map, whether that's your jungler, your support, your top laner. Just get rid of somebody on the map, create a 5v4, and try to win the game that way. And we'll see in the game-winning play, spoiler alert, that may happen. And then in the top lane, we have Aatrox and Mordekaiser. Aatrox and Mordekaiser are two very strong solo queue champions that have been picked up in pro play because they go even in most of their matchups, and they can contribute in team fights in different ways. Aatrox can solo carry a game. He's extremely explosive and causes some problems for the enemy team, because you basically need to build Grievous Wounds. You need to build Grievous Wounds for Aatrox because of Death Stance and Conqueror. Conqueror is also on Lee Sin. It's a very broken keystone, and that's one of the reasons why I don't think building Morellonomicon is a problem, even though that's kind of a hot topic right now, as people are complaining about rushing Morellonomicon as a first item. And while I agree that it's wrong as a first item, I think it's a very good choice for a second item on a lot of champions. But these champions really aren't being picked for their items, like I was saying earlier. I think when you're making item decisions for your team, it's more likely to have an impact if it's on your mid laner or your AD carry, because you can pick different parts of the game to play around based on your items that synergize well with your champion and your champion's kit, and when that champion naturally spikes as well. So you can kind of double down on what your champion is good at. So next, we're going to get into the game and analyze the game-winning play. All right, so we're about 21 minutes into the game, and before we watch how this play unfolds, let's get an item update and just an update on where they are in the game. So it's 3-3. Cloud9 has two dragons, and Team Liquid has one dragon. And right now, Cloud9 has a three-turret advantage, which has translated into a roughly 3,000 gold lead. Personally, I think a good rule of thumb is 2,000 gold. Once you're outside of 2,000 gold, the game starts to slip away from you, just because teams can continuously push their stat advantage to gain more stats and more stats and more stats, and they're just going to snowball out of control and kind of choke you out of the game. So it's really important to not fall too far behind in terms of towers and gold. In terms of towers, because that's an easy way to get gold, especially with turret plating. And that's one cool thing that Rift Herald has done, where the teams that are prioritizing Rift Herald and creating a tower advantage, it helps you to get additional towers because of how the waves end up playing out. But again, so let's check out on the items. So right now, Veigar, who we were saying is going to be a very important champion in this game, has Twin Shadows and Hextech GLP. So he has his two-item spike. And when we look at Azir, he has Gnasher's Tooth and Morellonomicon. If we were just looking at that matchup in a vacuum, I would say you're probably better off waiting until the full second item for Team Liquid, because they're at a 3,000 gold disadvantage. And that might not seem like a lot, but when you have a 3,000 gold disadvantage and you don't have your completed items, it means that you're not really getting the full efficiency of the items, because component pieces are not as strong as fully completed items. Once you go from a component item to a fully completed item, the return on investment gets a lot closer to 100%. And some items have over 100%, like Gnasher's Tooth. So I would say Team Liquid, they may have felt forced to do something in this situation, like they need to defend so that the enemy team doesn't get an easy Baron, but it's just not a good time to fight for them. They probably should have waited and really started contesting dragons and stuff like that. You can't give up a free Baron, but this isn't really the time to force things. And I think this was more of a misplay than anything. So let's take a look and see what happens. So Jarvan was running up to try to get some ward vision and contest the Baron pit, but he gets a Q from Lee Sin. Lee Sin goes in, insects him back into the baby cage. He tries to EQ out of it, which you can't do, and he dies. He had his flash up. He could have flashed out, and that's probably a big mistake that he regrets and would do differently if he had the chance. But now we look at C9. They're taking down Baron. Aphelios is great at taking Baron, which is one thing that has been noted about Senna, is that she's not a good champion at taking Baron. So they end up securing Baron, and no one else dies in this team fight. Impact ends up flashing out, but this is the play that balloons the gold advantage from 3,000 closer to 4,500. I think that one thing that we can all agree on, based off of watching professional matches and playing the game ourselves, is we understand that the game is often very close and games are decided by one or two big plays. And that's really why I think that paying more attention to items and picking your spots is much more important than people give credit to. In the professional scene, there are certain objectives that teams feel like they need to contest and need to compete for, and they're not really comfortable giving up chances at fighting, because there's always in the back of this mind, these players probably think that they can outplay their enemy. But instead of outplaying your enemy in the game, you can outplay your enemy in the preparation and in the pick ban phase and in understanding items, understanding champions, knowing how to play from behind. There are so many other ways to play the game other than outplaying. So I know that I drive home this idea of focusing on items and stuff like that, because it's one way to remove yourself from the in-the-moment decision-making, and it makes it a little simpler for you to be like, okay, well, I hit these item spikes, I see the enemy items, and I think I'm stronger than them right now. And that's a great time to fight. That doesn't mean that you have to stop looking for other kind of plays, like pick plays and hurting the enemy for being in the wrong position or doing something incorrect. It's just another thing to add to your arsenal to try to win games. And I think that we're very close to having the professional scene start implementing those kinds of ideas, because a lot of the commenters and content creators are making it a point of interest. So thanks for watching. Let me know if there are any things that you'd like me to take a look at, any specific games. I plan on going through most LCS games and trying to see if the decisions from pick ban end up impacting the game, because some games they will, some games they won't. That's just the way that it is. So again, thank you for watching. Please leave a comment, like, subscribe, and until next time, thank you very much.